This talk is about the Boost Units library. It's a tutorial. It's to make I'm going to talk a little bit about the library and hopefully promote the idea that this library gets more use and people get more benefit from it. My background is that I've been involved with Boost for a large number of years, maybe 10, 12 years. I'm the author of the Boost Serialization Library. I'm a regular user of Boost libraries. As everyone else, I have mixed results, sometimes because, well, for various reasons. And one of the libraries I had occasion to use was the Boost Units Library. I found it absolutely indispensable for what I was using, but absolutely frustrating in getting it to do what I wanted to do. So there I was caught in exactly the combination of circumstances where I don't want to be. And I'm hoping that if other people that find themselves in the same situation will find themselves with a path forward that will make the will give you the benefits without subjecting you to all the pain that I think that I was subjected to. So here's I had a little difficulty getting my audio video thing squared away just because, there we go. This is the problem that this library is meant to solve. Complex engineering scientific programs, they contain a lot of complicated formula. The simplest one would be velocity is equal to distance divided by time. But these can become arbitrarily complicated, and if you've got something like aircraft simulation or all sorts of things like this, it can be very, very tedious and very error-prone and require a huge amount of work to make sure that you don't make a mistake. What this library does, it's bad enough with the dimensions. Then when somebody starts to say, well, some of these constants or coefficients are in English units and other ones are in metric units, trying to keep track of all that and make all the conversions is pretty much, it's a very error-prone process. And there have been a number of high-profile disasters associated with exactly this. So the hope is that you guys are not going to be those guys. So let's start out with a simple illustration here. Okay, here is a very, very simple program. What it does is it takes an elapsed time, 2.7 seconds, a distance of 35 meters, and it calculates the velocity by dividing the two and then prints out the result. There's not too much to say about this. It's pretty transparent, and I have a pretty old computer here, and sometimes it seems to take a long time. So, and this is the result that we get the result we get expect to get, and where everybody's happy. There's just no problem. If the world was like this, and this is all we did, we'd be done. There'd be no problem. Okay, so let's. All right, so now we got our program running, and then of course the next guy comes along. And somebody fixes it, or maybe we introduce the error by mistake ourselves. And we instead of dividing the length by the elapsed time, we multiply it. Well, we compile that program. Now it's just a mistake in one character. I mean, anybody can make that kind of mistake. I mean, not me, but there are a lot of people that could make that kind of mistake, right? And by the way, you know, we're going to be able to check it, and it's never going to happen. But So this is sort of more of a theoretical example. In Bingo, the program compiles fine, works great, it's transparent, gives the wrong answer, but other than that, it's just fine. So, and this is because somebody made a mistake. There was no way for the compiler to detect it. It can't read the comments. So we're going to look for a method that helps us load more semantic information into the process so that it can detect errors of this nature. Okay, now this is a system, and it's contained in one program, that would actually address this problem for this case. And this is the basis for all systems that deal with this kind of issue. And in this particular case, you could just make it yourself if this was the only thing you're going to do. What you do is, instead of using float for elapsed time, you define your own type for elapsed time. And all that is a wrapper around a float. So this is something I'm also, should be pretty apparent. And so we do that for the for length, and we do that for velocity. And for each one, we overload the output operator so that whenever we use the C++ output operator, it prints the value. So our program would then become slightly different. Oh, and then there's a magic piece of key part up here. We define a function that takes as a length type and an elapsed time type, and it returns a velocity. And we assign that to the operator divide. So that now our main program looks just about exactly the same. We initialize an elapsed time, we initialize a length, and the velocity, you don't have to initialize because we're going to calculate it right here. And then we're going to run our program. And of course, bingo. This really dumb mistake we made before is detected right at compile time. Can't make it. It won't even build. You'll never get a wrong answer. And you might have problems, but this problem you won't have. Now, if we did this for all the types in, let's say, in a typical physics system, which has really only got it's like seven dimensions, and then we made the operators for each pair, we have about 50 little functions here. This actually, if that's all we were doing, could be made to work, be kind of tedious. That's just for one operator, the divide. So if we were going to say, well, we're using typically, 10 different operators, well, we'd still have like 500 of these things in here. Well, we could put in a header, and actually that could be made to work, and that would actually, that would be a step up for a lot of code, just that. And it's in dead simple, and that would actually help. It's incredibly transparent. Everybody can see how this works and what it does. It would be a checker, and it has zero runtime overhead, catches everything at compile time. It actually, a lot of code would be better off with just that very simple system. Now I'm gonna just to verify. Now what am I gonna do when I actually do that? Says, oh geez, of course I made a mistake. And so I bring up my editor. Right, and we'll just verify that, this is not a totally ridiculous example. Okay. Voila, it compiles, and there wasn't even any trouble with the compile time. In other words, there was no real extra noticeable compile time overhead. And voila, it produces the correct answer. So now we have a program with just sort of a little bit tedious, a little bit tongue hackery that would have to be done only once, but now will not produce the wrong answer. that, as I say, would be a step up for a lot of code. And this particular system, dumb as it is, could scale to even really complex formulae. So if you have a situation where you've got trying to simulate the lift of an aircraft based on a coefficient, when the coefficient is product of a really complicated formula, which is actually what occurs, this system would verify that all the dimensions work and operators are as you expect. So anyway, this has got some problems. Main problem is what? It's not scalable. It doesn't really handle more and more dimensions, and it basically would mean every time you added a new kind of a new set of a quantity with a new dimension set, you'd have to expand your system, and that would get old pretty quick. And of course, once you start adding that much code, you add a new source of error. So, anyway, so the solution here is to use the Boost Units library. The Boost Units library does, now we know what the library is going to do now because we just did it by hand. It's going to be a little more elaborate, but it's going to do that, to start with, the main task is going to do exactly what we just described. To do this, we don't have to add any of our own code. All we have to do is import the correct Boost headers. We don't need to specify the operations or dimensions for more complex units like velocity. Velocity is length divided by time, and all we have to do in the Boost units library includes the basic ones, but it also generates the combinations, so we're all done with that. It includes the ability to, when it streams data to the output, it includes the dimensions on it, and so that means it's another check. let's have a look at what happens when we start using that. All right. Okay. So here we include the Boost headers. In this particular example, we're only using three dimensions, time, length, and velocity, and that's pretty simple. There's some I/O operators for the Boost units. We include those. There's this header here. There's really, and we'll talk a little bit this down the road, but this needs to be included. I could have included just the whole damn thing by doing this, but when you do that, you kind of lose. It's not good for didactic purposes, and also makes the thing forever to compile. And I personally always just pick out and include the particular headers that I'm using, because it just makes my code. I don't like including stuff that I don't really understand. So anyway, I'm including the one thing I have to include is this class, which contains the concept of a quantity. A quantity is something like length, time, or whatever. So because what we've got is a couple of things going on here. We've got the meters and this and that, and then we have the actual quantity, which is, how long is something? So we'll look at it here. Now we look at our code here, and we generate three quantities. One is elapsed time, one is length, and one is velocity. The quantity is required. You have to indicate what units you're using, and also what underlying type you want to use, and then you're done. And from then on, it's pretty much like it was before, and we can test that out. Now, this PC is about like 12 years old, so I noticed when I was doing it on my home machine, the compilation is no problem at all as far as time concerned. And also, my expectations for what a compilation takes are so much different than they were when I bought this machine. But anyway, we can see that we got... I know it's in here. This thing failed to compile, but unfortunately, the error message is a little obscure. And that really depends on the machine one is doing. I happen to required from here. I can't decipher this right now. But I do happen to know that the mistake is is right here where it was before. And so if I...
It looks like a pretty good static assertion. It's trying to say that length times time is not convertible to velocity.
Well, now that's interesting, because I read the error. I know that's what it's saying. It's just that the way of saying it is really not real apparent to me. And actually, that surprises me, because when I've done this on my practice run, they just pop out in the right place. And I have done it with different compilers and different machines. So, you know, whatever. I mean, hey, this is a talk, you know. You always get surprises. Without that, it's no fun. So, anyway, but I'm going to correct this and verify that we can actually fix this, that my estimate's correct. What it is. I'm trying to make this thing... The boost units library really documentation really dwells a lot on all the stuff it can do. Unfortunately, it doesn't really. I found it exceedingly unhelpful in describing how to do it, and so having knowing what it can do without really knowing how to do something simple, I found very frustrating. So this time it did compile. And that's awful. Ah, interesting. I know, now I see. I got mixed up. You know what I did here? I put in the units, I fixed it, it compiles, but I failed to initialize the values. And in other words, what's the elapsed time? It's an uninitialized value. So that's actually, now I could have, well, that's kind of an interesting question. And I'm not going to dwell on that, because that would lead us totally in a different place. So, in fact, it did detect the error, but in a kind of a way that wasn't obvious to me. So, let's take a look more at the data types I'm going to show in a minute how to initialize that. And matter of fact, I think I'm going to do that right now, because it's really a dangling thing. So in this case, I try to initialize them. So still got problems. And why is that? The library doesn't really let me do an initialization like this. Because the real question, it when I do this, the question is 2.7 what? Now we're kind of crossing a boundary into, well, we got the dimensions squared away, but now we're looking at the units. And so I'm saying I'm assigning to the elapsed time 2.7, but if we don't know for a fact that the guy has seconds in mind when he does this, we're back into the same boat we were before. We're running a code, but we're not really verifying that the numbers we're putting in are consistent with each other. So one of the features when you use the boost library in this regard, it doesn't allow you to initialize something in this simple way, because this is too simple. So we're going to digress just a minute to talk a little bit now about the library. And it's really only got a couple types. Huh? Those types have many instances for different dimensions and whatever, but the types are relatively few. It should be simple to understand. It's not, but we're going to start here. And I'm not going to explain the whole library. I'm going to just show you where you get started. It has a concept of a base dimension. If I have units of physics, and I forget how many there are, five or six or something like that, mass, length, and whatever, each one of those is considered a base dimension, and that's one of their types. They have the concept of a dimension, which is just a list of the base dimensions. So they make, for example, a velocity is meters per second. So that's a meter raised to meter divided by seconds, or meters times the meters times seconds to the minus one. So anyway, this is the concept of dimensions, which you already touched upon. The other key data type are units. So one thing is we've got is dimensions, and then the other thing is how we measure them. We can measure length in feet, in meters, in centimeters, or whatever. So they have types to address that. The base unit is a unit which corresponds to, it corresponds to a base dimension, and then a unit is maybe several of those associated with what they call a system. I spent lots of time poring over the documentation. I never really found a cogent explanation for what a system is. So I'm not even going to touch upon that. The system basically consists of a list of base units, and that's where the magic happens, where farther down we're going to see how it automatically translates units from one measure to another. And it's very obscure. It's a black box. I'm sure the people that wrote it, who were very smart, thought it's a really good idea to hide this. Unfortunately, it hides it. So, and this is a key one that spend most of our time working with, which is a quantity of time measured in seconds. A quantity of time might be measured in minutes, or it might be measured in something else, but it's still a quantity of time. The same thing for length and these other units. So it boils down to just these three things. And we've already seen how the quantity works. And here I'm really focused on engineers and scientists who really want to write good code, and not people who want to spend a lot of time delving into vagaries of C++ type system or whatever. So we're not going to go too much into that, and we're just going to look at some more examples on how to use these things. Okay. So okie doke. We have the problem, which we still haven't resolved, about how to initialize things. The system won't let us initialize it with a naked value, 2.7. Well, that's actually not quite true. It has, each quantity has this static function, which basically lets you create another quantity from a raw float. So in this particular case, this highlighted statement here creates an instance of time quantity from a value float, and here we're assigning that to another time quantity, and so that at that point, the elapsed time will have the correct initial value. So now, this is the only change I made to the previous program, and that will actually now compile, and it will run as well, and give us what we want. So, and this also, now is a good time to recap this. Our unit system, when we have our output here, we're outputting our velocity and our length and our elapsed time. The output operators for quantities give us for free the description of what the measurements of those quantities are. In this case, it's 12.963 meters per second, and that's designated by the minus one. That equals 35 meters divided by 2.7 seconds. So, in fact, it's just by outputting this stuff, sometimes you're going to see something that is obviously a mistake. So, that would address that. Let's see what my Lex demo looks like. All right. Okay. But the problem in that previous syntax is It's ugly, it's error-prone, and it really has the same problem. It lets us ignore the system of measurements and whatever. We're really just cramming a value of 2.7 and into the time quantity without really checking whether it's seconds or minutes or whatever. So we're still not really over the hump to where we want to be in order to actually have this thing check that. And this is illustrated in this example here. our code has this, this is the key thing here, and this is a comment. But this is a comment because the quantity class already includes this. All the quantities which correspond to fundamental dimensions, they have defined a particular type. And for example, in the MKS system, when there's a we're up here. Let me just check something. We're using a quantity of meters. Just as we created a quantity with 2.7, well, they created a quantity with 1 there, and they named it meters. So then when we come down here and we do this, we initialize our seconds with this. Now, what we're saying here is take 2.7 and multiply it by this static standard quantity called seconds, and the implementation returns a new quantity instance with a value of 2.7 inside. So a quantity whose name is time is now got 2.7 in it because the seconds object has the right scaling, if any scaling is necessary. So in fact, there's minutes and whatever. I could say 2.7 minutes, and it would convert to the base units, which are the dimension uses. So at that point, now we have a program that's clearly documented what it's going to do. When I load the elapsed time in here, I have to say what units I'm using, and I know they're going to be correct, because if I were to try and put something like, we'll see this later, if I try to put feet in here, it's going to blow up. If I try to put, we use these pre-made quantities so that when we're initializing, we can use them, multiply by them, create a new quantity, and then assign it to the other one. So the whole type system is checking. We're not creating new stuff. We're using the stuff that's in there, and that guarantees it's actually correct. So our code here. Let's make sure it compiles. And I'll be damned. Same as before. So it's interesting to look at this and compare it to your own code. If you're writing scientific programs or programs with complex formulae, then when you look at this, this is something that you can actually look at and verify visually that it's exactly what you mean. This is the problem with the original version. This also describes exactly what you mean, but the compiler doesn't enforce it. So if you can imagine a situation where you've got a program that's now grown all over the place and it's got a problem with units or conversions or whatever, and now you can't find out where the mistake was, you could say, I'm giving up. I'm just going to transliterate that program over to the unit system and see what happens and try and compile it. And bingo, you've got an assistant there. He takes a while to get it done, but he does get it done, and that's a valuable thing. Of course, in this example, it's small enough to understand, but in principle, it works as complicated as the formulas can be. Yes? You could put minutes, hours. Well, because if I were to put feet here, then 2.7 feet, and it produces a quantity in feet. And now when I try and assign feet to time, It says no, because it's defined those operators so that, if I want to copy from one to the other, it's got to be the same dimensions. Huh? You could replace, well, you have to do a little work, and I'll get to that in a minute, because it's a very good question, and I think I'm just about there. So if you have just a little patience, it will be rewarded, and it's one of the best stories ever. So now, this is my favorite part of the whole demo. This is the LA Times article, and here's the link. I'm not going to open it up. I just quoted from it. NASA lost its $125 million Mars climate orbiter because spacecraft engineers failed to convert from English to metric measurements when exchanging vital data before the spacecraft was launched. Navigation team at Jet Propulsion Laboratory used the metric system of millimeters and meters in its calculations, while Lockheed Martin Astronautics in Denver, which designed and built a spacecraft, provided crucial acceleration data in the English system of feet and pounds. So for 14 months, this spacecraft was traveling on its way from the Earth to Mars, receiving commands in English system of units, and at the crucial time when it had to change something to parachute into the Martian atmosphere and descend and send back all this data, it plowed in. You want to be the guy that made that? And it's my consensus, it's my view that a system like this might ameliorate those situations. But there's a good news out of this story, that we don't see any connection between this failure and anything else going on at Lockheed Martin. This was not a failure of Lockheed Martin. It's a systematic failure to recognize and correct an error that should have been caught. They all got promoted. So I still say, don't be that guy. But anyway, I guess if you've been around long enough, you can do no harm. Okay, now let's talk about the system when I say, wait a minute, we got feet. And we want to load it in here. Now we're really getting to your question here. Whoops. So, oh right, where was I? All right. So, here we go. I've made a couple changes here, but the interesting one here is I imported from the Boost units library this header file called foot.hpp. Now, and then I created a type def, because this is the way that this is done is a little bit weird, but this describes a base unit, and each base unit has a type. This I didn't find in the documentation. I find it by perusing the code. It has a member which returns a type for the foot unit. And it's confusing to me that there are distinctions between base units and normal units, and the documentation is a little bit out of whack. The system works. It's just hard to follow. This is the system that I used in order to create these units. So I created a unit. This is basically just a static constant. It creates a type of foot, a type foot unit, and I called it foot. I created another one and called it feet, because I want to be able to see, 50 feet or 1 foot. And so now my code looks like this. This is what I had before, 2.7 seconds, but this time, and this time I multiplied by feet. And so everything should be hunky-dory. So let's see what happens here. Okay, it didn't like that. And this, of course, naturally, this is like a mistake. I mean, this is not what I meant to show. Well, delving into this a little bit, I look at the next example. It's the same one, excuse me. Here, this one does work. I'm going to actually modify this and just and comment this out so it'll compile. Voila. All right. Okay. So, I'm at E9 or E8? Now I forgot. Okay, now it compiles. And if I look at the code, I see the change that I made. It's a little bit subtle here. Oh, it's not subtle. It's just on the screen. It's a little hard to see. What I did was, the Boost Units library didn't do the automated conversion from 35 feet into the equivalent number of meters. It gave me an error there. Now, if you look in the Boost Units documentation, it has an explanation why it did that. The explanation is, they say, you know, if you assign feet to meters, you should really think about it. And so, in order to make you think about it, we're not going to do that conversion automatically. We're going to require that you use a static cast from the feet quantity. You should cast this. The result of this is feet. So you should cast the feet into your final value. So that the idea is that, now, it's interesting to me, they decided to do that. It's a very explicit decision. I can see where other people would have made a different decision. I could go either way. It's clear that they've done, I see some merit in their point of view. I also see the merit in my first instinct. I was surprised when this didn't work. But, you know, now that I work with the thing and I'm kind of used to it, I'm thinking, well, maybe they have a point. As a practical matter, I was fine with this. On the project that I use this, I did not want to go and muck around with the library. I had other stuff to do. And for me to muck around with this thing, which is the kind of beast you never want to go into, they couldn't pay me for that. I said, okay, I'll swallow my tongue and I'll include this static cast here. Actually, when I got used to it, I was fine with it. I got used to it. It wasn't an issue. And maybe they're right. I don't know. If it really bugged you, you know, you could probably make your own conversion, or you could tweak the library. From my perspective, it let me move on. And it does actually require that you actually realize that you're making a conversion. A lot of C++ problems come in general from implicit conversions. And so I'm sure that that's what they were thinking, that's a good thing to avoid doing. So, and now this guy works great, compiles fine. Any conversion of units. Yeah, I have to think about that. I'm wondering, it does, actually. Even if you convert from seconds to hours, let's suppose I want to put meters per hour in velocity and assign it to velocity, it would trap it and say, don't do that. Convert it to meters per second explicitly. Well, whatever. it was a surprise to me. I thought it was a mistake. And then they did. There was one thing in the documentation. They did have a little section where they described that. And they convinced me. It was, and I moved on from that. I was just surprised because everything else works pretty automatically, and hides everything. And yet this they exposed. I think this is a question of taste, and. People going to differ on taste, so. No, I'm sure what the core of the argument was that the question is, Why do they require a static cast to convert from quantities in from one quantities measured in one units to the same quantity measured in a different unit? And their reasoning is that we don't want to see things converted implicitly without people being aware of it. So if you're if you're taking a measurement in feet and you're converting it to a measurement in meters, then you should really double check that. It shouldn't do that without requiring that you explicitly tell us that that's what you want to do. I know that that's their argument, and that's a good argument. But somebody would also say, yeah, but it makes the code look ugly and it makes it whatever. But as I say, it boils down to a question of taste. And at that point, discussion's over. Remind me to repeat the question. I always forget to do that. If there are any other questions. So, what I did here is, the only thing I did here was to move the header code, the other code that I had, which kind of described my system, into a header called E9, because that's the stuff from E9 we're going to be using subsequently. And it, all it does is really generate the particular units and things that we're using in our example. And it also allows me to illustrate to compare with our original example, and I hope it's clear, or I hope that people are convinced that the upper one is much easier for somebody working with scientific data or engineering data, or coding for a medical instrument, or a flight control system, or something that can't tolerate any kind of mistake, that it's going to be more correct and more likely to be correct and easier to understand the top bit of code than the bottom bit of code. And it's also my hope that by illustrating that we can do it just by this include, and we saw all the includes in the previous code, that it doesn't create an extra burden for us. It's almost free. And that's the essential thing. There are many libraries that give you the benefits, but the investment that it requires to get the benefit is not worth the benefit you're going to get. And I believe that this library is sufficiently well made that it can do that if it's explained properly and you don't get lost in the documentation. That's the point of my talk here. And this kind of sums up what I'm selling here. Okie doke. Now's actually a good time if anybody has a question, because I think that I don't know what I'm going to do next, but that's actually illustrates in a nutshell the point of what this whole talk is about.
So I saw when you streamed out the value of the dimensions. When you stream the value, did it pass the
Very good question. And you know, when I was looking at it, I said, this is very cool. But you know what it really needs? What's the sign say here? Yeah. The question is, we see that it adds the dimensions and the units for those dimensions when it streams out the data. This is really helpful, and it comes for free. Great stuff. What about when we input data? Damn, doesn't have it. And by the way, somebody wants a summer project, I think that would be a great one. It's small enough to do, and yet really would be worth doing. And I maybe we'll try and get some Google Summer of Code person to do it or whatever. It would also be a very, very interesting application for the Spirit Library. There's a lot of interesting aspects to that. So I would love to, when I saw that, and I came up with the same question, and I think that would be great.
Compliance, everything's like in time for
all the dimensions, incorporating send a chrono for the time dimension. And I would love to have something like that in the standard. A boost unit, as it is, what I see today, is not up to be able to be standardized today because it's retro C++ and not current C++.
Well, as far as standardization, there's a lot of other reasons why it wouldn't be. But I think what you're referring to is not boost units, because I haven't displayed one line of code from boost units. What you're referring to is my examples are very retro, which is true.
For example, just for the literals, I wouldn't write the times meters, but using the
UEL software. Well, that's an interesting question. Personally, I'm not sold on that scheme. Other people are, and there's in the minute one proposed that, it would be a controversial thing. But let's step back just a little bit. This library is compatible with C++ 098. It's implemented. It does not use any C++ 11 or 14 to implement. So you're correct in that regard that it doesn't use modern C++ to do these things. And I'm sure the implementation would be much simpler if it were done with the user stuff. But my focus here isn't on the implementation. My focus is on the person that uses it as a black box. And as I say, I've yet to display one line of code from the library itself. And so the criticism that it looks very retro.
I wasn't criticizing the use of boost units. I love things like that. I was asking for having a version that is implemented in a modern way that we can actually propose for standardization.
Okay. Well, let's just talk about the API. Well, is the only thing that we really come up so far is this example of using the meter quantity to generate a temporary quantity. Now, the thing is, I would have to think about that, but if you were to use the suffix syntax you're talking about, I don't know that that can be generated on the fly. I think that has to be kind of built in. I don't know. It's not the focus of my talk. I think it's interesting. I see by the large number of people here, there's a lot of interest in using boost units. So I think that the idea that this would be head towards standardization is way beyond my pay grade right now. Steve. Yeah. Okay. I left for the end. What has to be done to fix this? And the worst part is that as I've described it here, it looks a lot simpler than it is, because I've stuck to simple examples. And these simple examples demonstrate the power, and one can go a long way with that. Unfortunately, the way the documentation is presented, it's very hard to see these simple examples. So this idea of such a library, it would be immensely, frankly, every engineering and scientific program should use this. As far as I know, almost zero are. And the reason is, we'll get to in a moment, but the reason is that as it's constantly constituted, it's too hard to use. And the thrust of my talk here is, well, it's got a lot of problems, but it's good enough to use if we're kind of careful about the way we use it. And I would also like to see more people use it in the hope that we could get more interest to see more effort invested in it. But it's frankly not at a critical mass now. That's a real problem. Yes?
So a couple of comments. One is a guy named Walter Brown, who's been working on a Unix library for a long time and not releasing it because the language wasn't quite up to what he wanted to do. And from what I understand, the language is really close to being what he needs. So that's sort of a competitor approach in the realm there. I think I understand what that system is there for, which is if you have a system of units, all of which are orthogonal, then you only have to keep track of the power associated with each of the units, and your representation is relatively low. If you're not in a system of units, then you have to worry about whether meters and inches are the same dimension.
I get that. And my real criticism and my comment on that is there's two aspects. One is it's not well described at all in the documentation. And the thrust of my talk here is, since it comes with complete systems already, we don't really, to use the library, we don't really have to understand it below a certain level. And it's my view that it can be very, my real target and interest are not C++ programmers that write the stuff that we write, but I really would like to see, I would like to be able to tell scientists and engineers, hey, C++ gives you a huge benefit if you use it. And you don't have to know template metaprogramming. You don't have to know all of that. You can get benefit today just by using what's available. Now, under the covers, there's lots of issues going on. It doesn't use the latest techniques. It's who knows what. I do know personally at least one of the persons that invested effort in this. The guy is a genius. It's Stephen Watanabe, and he's the one that kind of finished this off. It uses incredibly complicated template metaprogramming to keep track of the dimensional analysis and automatically generate the units that are results of all operations. It's a place that most of us don't want to go. And it's my thesis here is it's a place that most of us don't need to go. Now, Steve probably wants to go there because that's where he lives. But the rest of us, I just want to make sure I get no mistakes. Lawrence.
So I think the real issue there is not how it's implemented, but the constraints on use. So for instance, if you have, you write an expression, 3 inches plus 4 meters. In some of these, you might not be able to do that, right? In some, you may be able to do that. I think that's an essential requirement. And one is, can you define a unit that might not be horribly related to any particular system of units, right? For instance, dollars, right?
Okay.
You say, $3 plus 8 feet.
Okay, I have I'm not going to finish all I have. The next piece really is how to create your own unit. And on the other hand, I only have 10 minutes here, and I'm just going to touch upon that. But and because now we're at the point where I'm just going to show the code because it's just too it requires more explanation than I can. Then I can actually justify at this point. But this demo, creating your own units is not super hard. I have it here as part of the demo. It's very hard to figure out how to do it from reading the documentation, which is a separate issue. So the thrust of my argument here is that Boost Units has everything in it. It does everything we want to do. It's just really hard to figure out how to make it do that. And so I don't really, and whether it's, and how it's implemented, honestly speaking, at the level that I'm concerned, these are not interesting questions for me. I know that it does everything I should do. My real problem is how to make it do that. And so let's just jump ahead just to give a little taste of making your own unit. Okay. I think these, if I recall correctly, are basically ways to just simplify a little bit. Let's have a look. Aha. Here's how you make your own unit. This is a small demo of how to do it. It's all built on layers and layers of this. And here I've taken a the volume here. Here it is. I've taken the volume unit and I've created a couple static units that in order to bring them into the namespace. And here I have. Let's have a look. Aha! This is the magic. And here are I've just imported into the namespace time-based unit, but I've defined here a new unit called consumption rate. Consumption rate depends on a dimension, a length dimension with an exponent of 3, a cubic meter. And it depends upon a time-based dimension of exponent minus 1. So consumption rate, and this is the example here is aircraft fuel consumption, is measured in the base dimension realm in cubic meters per second. Now, it turns out that in the real world, they don't use that commonly. They use pounds per minute. So now we got a way to reach. But at this point in the demo, I'm just showing you can make your own unit. And this is all the close you, this is all you require to make your own unit. It's just here. And at that point, you can start using it. And I just, and this is very similar to all the other examples, and make elapsed time, make capacity, and I figure burn rate. So that, making your own unit, it's like 100 times easier than you think it would be by looking at the documentation. So, and I'll just, and here's the same example that I've done by, it's just slightly more, I added in gallons and liters, so that I could, you know, input the same information, the fuel capacity, so I could input it in gallons and automatically convert it to the volume in the standard set of units, and then I can generate the burn rate. And in it turns out I can use my own units, gallons per minute or whatever it is, and still generate the burn rate. But the burn rate is still calculated, unfortunately, or in its output in cubic meters per second. So, but then there's a fix for that. And then I just made a conversion which allows me to convert it on output back into gallons per pounds per second or whatever. I got totally mixed up. But that's kind of illustrates the value of this thing. By describing the units piece by piece and the conversion piece by piece, now I don't have to keep the whole thing in my head at once. And that's the value of the system, that I can now write a program that I can't understand, which would have required all my mental capacity before to keep track of the conversions and the units and all of that. I'm not going to go into these in detail because we don't have the time. I will make them available. They are very simple. I think that you'll agree that the examples that I presented seem very, very simple as I explain them anyway. This is not significantly more complicated. It's just a little bit more magic. And now I want to touch upon the other thing that irks me. Is okay. Here's a we got a powerful tool to make programs correct. Almost zero runtime overhead, as far as I can tell. Almost zero conceptual overhead. I can write code. I write code to do what I want it to do. I don't have to figure out what I want to do and then translate it into some other thing and write that. Anybody who looks at my code, even if they've never seen the Boost Units library, can look at that code and see what it's doing. They might not believe me, but at least we're in agreement that what the thing is supposed to be doing. I believe it's indispensable to any organization that must produce correct software that's involved in scientific or engineering calculations. Embedded systems, flight control, medical instruments, scientific instruments, engineering calculations, like, well, any kind of thing. Who wants to produce software that's got bugs in it? Nobody. Who wants to tediously check all this stuff all the time? Nobody. This is the solution. Why doesn't everybody do this? This thing is made by some of the smartest people I know. It's got problems, but it's not because these guys are not smart. It's a good implementation. The compile times are reasonable. You guys saw the things here. This is a 12-year-old PC. on my own machine, it's undetectable. The library itself, as far as I know, has no bugs. It might have some. It has a very comprehensive coverage of the whole domain. It's got all sorts of units for all sorts of dimensions. It's very unlikely that you'll have to create your own. I had to stretch to find a situation where I had to create my own unit. A large portion of software could do the thing just exactly as I made these demos here, bringing in the pieces that have what you want, adding just a little bit of sauce, and then writing your code. It has extensive documentations with lots of examples. Well, what's the problem? Okay. Well, here's it in a nutshell. The documentation is totally exhaustive, absolutely correct, but not at all helpful. And the fundamental problem is that this documentation is not based, and the system itself is not based on a system of type requirements or concepts, whichever word you want to use. The guys just got started. They wrote the thing. They made it work. It worked. They included some doxygen in there, which just repeats the code. But by not putting in the concepts, they have two problems. One is it diminishes its conceptual integrity. We've got things called base units and units and base dimensions and dimensions. It's very confusing. We've got unit types, which are called volume, and other things called similar names. So that's part of the problem. I think that if they'd used concepts, that would have helped. The other thing is when you look at the documentation and it's a template, it doesn't describe specifically what the requirements on the type parameter are. And that means that you have to look at the code, and then you're lost. The drum I'm beating here is, up until now, I'm saying, you guys use this. If you stick to the simple stuff like I've shown here, you can go a huge distance. And now I'm saying to the developers that are not here to listen to this, if you'd have used concepts and built them in from the beginning, then we wouldn't have this problem. The thing would be better documented. The code would be easier to understand. We could build more checking. You know those gigantic error messages we're getting? We wouldn't get those. We would get those at the site of the mistake instead of seeing that much stuff. So for some odd reason, a large number of boost libraries do not contain type requirements, and even fewer actually enforce them using the facilities of boost. This is an object lesson in how smart people can go wrong. They've created this fantastic thing, which is only used probably 1% of the time that it should be used. It's a lesson. If you want to make something, if your measure of success is to make something cool, fine. If your measure of success is to make something that's going to change the world, read this page. That's my shtick here. So I think I'm done here, and I'm willing to entertain any questions that anybody would like to have. How am I doing on time? I'm about right, right? Yeah. No, as far as I can tell, not. Steve Watanabe does answer questions on it sometimes, and he has fixed bugs. But as far as I know, it's not in active development. I would love to see somebody take as a Google Summer of Cone project to add concepts to this package. I think that would be. It would be a heck of a job, but I do think it's doable, and I think that it would be a sea change. I mean, then we'd have something to sell, which is easier to sell. But, and so if you want to take that up, you know, talk to me, and I'll introduce you to the right people. There, that's all in there. Believe me, the thing is comprehensive. You're not going to say, oh, does it have that? You're not going to catch them like that. You're going to, it's in there. It's like, that must be a commercial. Isn't that like for some soup or something? You know, it's got garbanzo beans. It's in there. Believe me, it's in there. The problem is, it's hard to get to. So it's not the implementation. It's not the package. It's the way the package is packaged. You know, that's, when I looked at that, I said, and I talked about that already, the exact same occurred to me. Why the heck, it's the same dimension. Why is it trapping it? Well, and then they did specify their reasoning for that. I say, okay. Maybe they got a point here. It's a question of taste. And then I moved on. But taste can differ. I can't spend my life arguing about stuff that I can't really prove. So there we are.
I just want to know, is there a specific reason why you use float instead of double?
No specific reason. It's just my habit. It's a bad habit, but it's got absolutely nothing to do with anything. So I use float in my examples. You could use double. Very interesting. I believe that you could use any other integer-like type, like boost multi-position integer. I believe that's true, and that tells you about the quality of the implementation, that the quality of the implementation is good. It's just that it's not apparent when you read it, and you have to discover it by running experiments like that. But that's a very interesting, that touched upon a different point. In my particular case, I just took float because that's just what I do. No, that's not a function of the units or dimension. That's a function of the operations on the underlying types. So that would be factored into a different issue, into a different place. Now, if you want to touch upon that, I'm now flogging my safe numerics library, which is in development at the Boost Library Incubator. Though the numbers produced by that do check for those problems, and I believe that they could be plugged into this, because they're meant to model integers, and these guys, I know they included the underlying type, not a float and not a double, but anything that models an arithmetic type. So this is all on the same page. It's just great. Our problem here is the rest of us. It's not this. So if somebody really interested, if I were an engineering company like Lockheed or whatever, I would say, wait a minute here, get one smart guy and sit him down for 6 weeks and just write a new document for this thing. And I mean, of course, you know, they got billions of dollars to spend on, well, I guess the Mars orbiter, but they don't have a budget for that. Okay, any more questions? Well, I very much appreciate your coming to my talk. You people are a member of a very select and exclusive group. And as I say, I'm gratified that you come. And I hope that at least some people will be able to use this in real world problems, as opposed to some kind of template metaprogramming thing that nobody's going to understand. But I do believe that the investment in the effort invested in this is going to really pay off. Well, thank you very much.